Welcome to Norfolk Perspective City Slice. I'm Bob Batcher, and we've got a really special one for you. Got a great story I want you to tell. It's not necessarily, it is kind of has some happiness in it. It's a tough journey, but there's some joy and there's some sadness in it. And Steve Kolb, I got you down as a C9ID project coordinator, but you're a friend. We go way, way back,
yes,
and I got to tell you, Virginia, your wife is a very special person to our family because she was a real mentor to our daughter and an awesome performer, but she's in a different stage of life now, isn't she?
Yes, she is. Yeah,
let's talk about it.
Virginia was diagnosed in December of 2011 with ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, and it's a devastating disease. And some people would say it's one of the very worst diseases that you can have. She's lost in 18 months a lot of the abilities. Certainly, her ability to sing is one of the most prominent, but also it affects walking and it affects hands and ultimately affects your breathing.
Okay, I want you to go back, I don't know, let's say 2 years.
Sure.
What was the biggest word you knew?
The biggest word? Yeah, I certainly learned a lot of big words in the last 18 years. And some of them have brought a lot of hope. Some of them are very, related to research. And it's been a wonderful opportunity. Both of us have actively engaged. It's been our choice to get engaged with knowledge about research. And then ultimately a project trying to facilitate research as well.
Now to go back 2 years, we would have, if our conversation would have been wrapped around music.
Would have been talking music.
Probably
yes.
A little bit about church.
Yes.
The kids.
Right.
And now the conversation's wrapped around some hope.
Yes, it is.
But how did that transition? Because, a lot of husbands, me included, would have been, woe is me.
Well, life is not for the faint of heart. And you face a challenge, you receive a challenge, and everyone does. I'm sure everyone who's listening can point to something in their life that they weren't expecting, came out of left field, so to speak. Then you adapt, you change, you grow. And it's a choice. I mean, you don't have to do those things. I guess like you said, you could just sit and say, woe is me. But I think one of the things that we found is that engagement with this has brought us a lot of joy and a lot of satisfaction and the sense that we're going to be able to make a difference.
And you've met some special people along your journey.
Yes, we certainly have.
Teresa Harrell?
Yeah.
You kind of come in as a third party.
I'm with the ALS Association. I am the Care Services Coordinator, and so I actually help any ALS patient or anyone who's been diagnosed with the disease throughout their journey. The chapter, we provide a lot of free services to our patients. It's not based on financials or what they have. Anyone who has ALS can receive services from us. We have support groups, we have medical equipment loan closets, transportation grants, respite care grants. So we just try to support anyone who's affected by this horrible disease.
Now, do you remember the first time you met Stephen?
I do.
In Virginia?
I do.
Describe him then. Come on, we haven't rehearsed this.
He came in and he came to our support group. That was our first meeting. It was actually meeting in a library.
Yes, ma'am.
And he just came in, and the group itself is very wild, to say the least. And he really fit in right away, and he just came in to really just learn as much as possible. And so since that point, he's just been very engaged. Want to know what's going on, what can he do, connecting with other families and caregivers and providing a lot of support. So
it's been awesome. Steve, this is a journey that has a destination, doesn't it?
Yeah. The ALS is a disease with a very short life expectancy. It's 40% of patients die within 3 years of diagnosis. 90% of patients die within 5 years of diagnosis. There's been a lot of research, a lot of work that's been done in terms of patient care that has made life a lot better for patients. Treatments that bring comfort and can impact some of the symptoms. But there hasn't been much that's really impacted the course of the disease. Until recently.
Mm-hmm.
We have some change.
Yeah, there's some cool stuff that's come
there
up
really
out.
Is. Yeah.
Turning a switch on and off?
Well, yeah.
Did I get that right?
That's maybe getting a little ahead of us. But yeah, there's some huge breakthroughs. One in particular in 2011. That was like the banner year for ALS research since it was discovered in 1869. And and what's so exciting about this is it was identification of a specific mutation. ALS is a disease that includes a number of mutations that have been identified. But this mutation was found in both the familial cases where people clearly see it in their family. Mother or father has died of the disease, and maybe some siblings, grandparents, and it's really spreading through the family. And also in the sporadic form of the disease, we're really not even sure where it's coming from. Suddenly it just seems to pop up, and someone is showing the signs of the symptoms of the disease. So this particular mutation was discovered. C9ORF72 is the name of the mutation, and it was discovered in 2011. And right from the start, they knew this was exciting. Researchers knew because it was similar to a mutation that had been discovered before in another disease area. So it kind of launched us ahead about 10 years in terms of research.
Now, again, you're using researchers rather than practitioners because it's really in the research stage where you're having to gather groups of people in that, right? So isn't that part of one of your missions?
Yes.
To identify people?
Yes. Virginia's doctor, we fly every 3 months up to see Dr. Merit Sidkovich in Boston at Mass General Hospital, and she has been a leading light in the field of ALS research. Is one paper that I read referred to her. And she really, her commitment is to take the bench, the science, and bring those treatments from the bench to the bedside, translating the research into actual treatment for patients. So that's been a strong emphasis. And that's the project that we're involved in, something that facilitates that.
And that's not an easy project to pull off the ground, is it?
No, it's an expensive project. That's just because there's so much involved with a trial or any kind of research project, so many different factors.
I kind of facetiously asked you what was the biggest word you knew, 2 years ago. I mean, it can be overwhelming.
Yes.
But it's on a human side, and I know that you've got some resources available, such as websites, things like that kind of bring it down to earth so you can understand.
Well, we have a Facebook page. Is actually, I think, the
wow.
Website. Wow. Forget the website. No, we have been talking about a website. But in the meantime, Facebook is such a wonderful way to reach to people. And we've been able to, via that page, draw in people into this discussion from across the country, in fact, even maybe a little bit overseas as well, to draw them into this discussion. And the Facebook page is simply called C9ID. So it refers to chromosome 9, which is where this mutation occurs, and then ID identification. What we're hoping to do is to raise the funds for a project to identify patients. What this does is it takes research that's ongoing and it gets it to the bedside faster. It accelerates the process of the treatment work from the research side to the patients. There's a company already working on the treatment, and the C9ID project will actually get it to patients sooner.
Wow. Now, I know that you're bringing people together all over the country,
yes,
starting here, to really kind of talk about it, because it is something, it can be very personal, but really sharing the story. Is this what you're seeing, Teresa, in support groups, by sharing the story?
Yeah, sharing the story and building a partnership with everyone that you meet. It's huge to get through this journey.
Now, I know by the time things are happening so quickly that by the time we close this conversation out and get it up on YouTube, there's going to be some new advances. So give me that website, too, that somebody might want to go to find out more about what's going on or some opportunities coming up in the near future.
You can go to our chapter website, which is www.alsinfo.org, to find out more about ALS.
Okay.
One of the things that I want to highlight about that is that there's a research link.
And yes, there is a research link.
And if someone really wants to dive in, as we have chosen to dive in, and to some of the research, and to see some webinars by Dr. Sidkovich and some other amazing doctors working in all different areas of therapy, gene therapy and stem cells and other avenues of research, you can go to the research link on that page and see those webinars. And
they're so
really
don't
fantastic.
Avoid it thinking you won't understand it. It really brings it into the
They work very hard to make them accessible, yes.
Steve, I want to, on a personal level, say thank you for bringing Virginia's story and Steve's story to the set, and so that we can talk about it, but also get people engaged in making a difference. And that's what you guys have all done. So visit, your Facebook page is?
C9ID.
It's very easy. And thanks a lot. And thank you for joining us. And see you at the gym?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you.